فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. We are in the explanation of the kitab مختصر في أصول العقائد الدينية written by العلامة الشيخ عبد الرحمن بن ناصر السعدي. And today, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to take the last and final asl, al-asl al-khamis. So we're going to conclude with the asl al-khamis, inshallah ta'ala, in which the author, rahimahullah ta'ala, has placed at the ending of the book. After he spoke about matters of aqidah, he then, inshallah ta'ala, concluded with this asl. Tafadhal.
Al-asl al-khamis. تاريخهم في العلم والعمل، وذلك أن أهل السنة والجماعة يعتقدون ويلتزمون أن لا طريق إلى الله وإلى كرامته إلا بالعلم النافع والعمل الصالح. فالعلم النافع هو ما جاء به الرسول من كتاب الله وسنة رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم، فيجتهدون في معرفة معانيها والتفقه فيها أصولا وفروعا، ويسلكون جميع طرق الدلالات فيها، دلالة المطابقة ودلالة التضمن ودلالة الالتزام، ويبذلون قواهم في إدراك ذلك بحسب ما أعطاهم الله، ويعتقدون أن هذه هي العلوم النافعة، هي وما تفرع عليها من أقيسة صحيحة ومناسبات حكمية، وكل علم أعان على ذلك. وكل علم أعان على ذلك أو وازره أو ترتب عليه فإنه علم شرعي، كما أن ما ضاده وناقضه فهو علم باطل. فهذا طريقهم في العلم. وأما طريقهم في العمل فإنهم يتقربون إلى الله تعالى بالتصديق والاعتراف التام بعقائد الإيمان التي هي أصل العبادات وأساسها، ثم يتقربون له بأداء فرائض الله المتعلقة بحقه وحقوق عباده مع الإكثار من النوافل وبترك المحرمات والمنهيات تعبدا لله تعالى. ويعلمون أن الله تعالى لا يقبل إلا كل عمل خالص لوجهه الكريم، مسلوكا فيه طريق النبي الكريم، ويستعينون بالله تعالى في سلوك هذه الطرق النافعة التي هي العلم النافع والعمل الصالح الموصل إلى كل خير وفلاح وسعادة عاجلة وآجلة. والحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا.
So ختم المصنف رحمه الله, the author رحمه الله, he concluded his book with this asl, al-asl al-khamis. He concluded with this, rahimahullah ta'ala. And that is, bayanu tariqi, he clarifies for us, rahimahullah, the path of Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah in knowledge and implementation. Tariquhum fil ilmi wal amal. How Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah are in terms of knowledge and how they are in terms of implementation. Because what we know is فَدِينُ أَهْلِ السُّنَّةِ وَالْجَمَاعَةِ, the religion of أَهْلِ السُّنَّةِ وَالْجَمَاعَةِ لَيْسَ عَقَائِدٌ قَلْبِيَةٌ. It's just, it is not عَقَائِدْ قَلْبِيَةٌ فَحَسْبْ. It is not only internal beliefs alone. بَلْ دِينُ أَهْلِ السُّنَّةِ وَالْجَمَاعَةِ, rather the belief and the religion of أَهْلِ السُّنَّةِ وَالْجَمَاعَةِ is عَقَائِدْ قَلْبِيَةٌ, and it is also حَقَائِقْ إِيمَانِيَةٌ تَبْدُو عَلَى الْجَوَارِحِ, that becomes apparent on the limbs. So Ahli Sunnati wal Jama'ah, their belief is just not things that stay internally in their heart only. Rather, it manifests and it resonates on their limbs. It is seen on their Jawarih and Arkan. And Ahli Sunnati wal Jama'ah also have a path, يَسْلُكُونَهُ, which they take في تحصيل العلم والعمل, in how they gain knowledge and how they sought knowledge and how they implement the knowledge which they have gained. And that's where the author, rahimahullah, he says.
وذلك أن أهل السنة والجماعة يعتقدون ويلتزمون أن لا طريق إلى الله, ألا طريق إلى الله وإلى كرامته إلا بالعلم النافع والعمل الصالح. فالعلم النافع هو ما جاء به الرسول من كتاب الله وسنة رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم, فيجتهدون في معرفة معانيها والتفقه فيها وصولا وفروعا.
So the Sheikh rahimahullah, he here tells us that أن أهل السنة والجماعة يعتقدون, they believe, ويلتزمون, and they stick by, ألا طريقة, there is no path, إلى الله, to Allah, وَإِلَىٰ كَرَامَتِهِ, and the honor of Allah تبارك وتعالى, and Allah bestowing His honor, and إِلَّا بِالْعِلْمِ النَّافِعِ, except with beneficial knowledge. وَالْعَمَلِ الصَّالِحِ, are you trying to gain Allah تبارك وتعالى, and you want to get to Him? Is that what you want? Is that you want to gain Allah honoring you? If you want to, then the Sheikh said there is no way, إِلَّا بِالطَّرِيقِ الْعِلْمِ النَّافِعِ, except beneficial knowledge, وَالْعَمَلِ الصَّالِحِ, and righteous actions. Then he defines what it means by an ilmu nafi', beneficial knowledge. What does he mean by it? فَالْعِلْمُ النَّافِعُ, beneficial knowledge is هُوَ مَا جَاءَ بِهِ الرَّسُولُ, it is what the Prophet has come with صلى الله عليه وسلم, من كتاب الله, from the book of Allah, وَسُنَّةِ رَسُولِهِ, and the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم sunnah. فَيَجْتَهِدُونَ, and they strive فِي مَعْرِفَةِ مَعَانِيهَا, أهل السنة, they strive in knowing what's in the book of Allah and the sunnah, وَالتَّفَقُّهِ فِيهَا, and to have true understanding and comprehension of it. Usul, and whether those matters are issues which are asal, or whether they are issues which are furu', sub-branches issues. Okay? So here the Shaykh rahimahullah is telling us that the path to Allah, the path to gain honor, is with two things. Al-ilmu nafi' wal-amalu salih. Beneficial knowledge and righteous actions. And that is exactly what Allah said in the Quran. هُوَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِالْهُدَى وَدِينِ الْحَقِّ لِيُظْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّهِ. هُوَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِالْهُدَى. Allah sent the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم with what? What did Allah send the Prophet with? He sent the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام with two things. هُوَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِالْهُدَى, عِلْمُ النَّافِعِ, وَدِينِ الْحَقِّ, الْعَمَلُ الصَّالِحِ, beneficial knowledge and righteous actions. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi came to give us beneficial knowledge and also to what? Implement that knowledge. ولذلك, the first verses that came down from the Quran were what? اقرا بسم ربك الذي خلق, خلق الانسان من علق, اقرا وربك الاكرم الذي علم بالقلم. So here Allah tabaraka ta'ala is telling us that read, gain beneficial knowledge. And ikhwani, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He raises those who have knowledge over those who don't have knowledge. Even if they're both believers, the one who has knowledge has a higher station, a higher rank than the ordinary Muslim. Does the Muslim have a higher rank than the disbeliever? Naam. But within the believers, we're not all ala watiratin wahida, ala martabatin wahida. We're not all of one level. We have different levels and different stations amongst ourselves. And that's why Allah says in the ayah, يرفع الله الذين آمنوا منكم والذين أوتوا العلم درجات. So from within the believers, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala raises the station of the believers. So a believer who has high aspiration, who doesn't want to just enter Jannah, but rather he wants to gain a big place in Jannah, he wouldn't let that high station be something he misses out on. And he would want to gain that high station. Rather, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He specified fear in the hearts of the, He specified fear for of him, He specified it for the ulama. And He says, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَى. And here Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He put the what? He put the maf'ul before the fa'il. And this shows al-hasr, exclusivity. Meaning there is no one who truly fears Allah the way he deserves to be feared except who? The scholars. And why is it that they fear Allah the most? It's because of what? Al-ilm al-nafi'. They have that knowledge. So the Shaykh rahimahullah here is telling us that ma'rifatu al-deen, knowing the religion, bil-adillah, with evidences, textual understanding, that is what? What is it? That is the way for a person's actions to be better. So the more you gain knowledge, the more your implementation would be. And the more your acts would be. Naam. And the knowledge is not all one level within itself. There are ulum and sciences that you have to know which are fardu ayn, and every individual has to know it. And there are knowledge which is fardu kifaya, which is إِذَا قَامَ بِهِ بَعْضُ سَقَطَ عَنِ الْبَاقِينَ إِذَا قَامَ بِهِ بَعْضُ سَقَطَ عَنِ الْبَاقِينَ. If a group of people stand up to learn it, then the rest don't have to learn it. You don't have to come with it. So one may ask, what's the had, what's the dabid for the knowledge which is fardu ayn from the knowledge that is fardu kifaya? What's the dabid for it? Al-Imam al-Ajurri rahimahullah, in his kitab Fadl al-Ilm, he has a risala called Fadl al-Ilm. Ibn al-Qayyim in his kitab I'lam al-Muwaqqi'in, al-Qarafi, al-Imam al-Qarafi rahimahullah, al-Imam al-Qarafi, al-Maliki in his book Al-Furuq, all of them, they mention that the knowledge that a person has to know and he's not excused for being ignorant of it is أَنَّ كُلَّ مَا تَوَقَّفَ الْعَمَلُ عَلَيْهِ. It is anything which you can't implement unless you have knowledge of it. You can't. فَإِنَّ الْعِلْمَ بِهِ وَاجِبٌ. Knowing that thing becomes obligatory. For instance, the hakam of the salah is obligatory on everybody having to know it. You see? Because we have to pray. So you need to know what is it that can nullify your prayer and what is it that is requested and needed from you in your prayer. For example, a person goes into business and trading. Are you there? And he becomes a business man. Or a woman becomes a businesswoman. She starts going to business. It becomes fardu ayn on them to learn the ahkam of buyu', ahkam al-buyu', and learning al-buyu' al-manhiyu anha shar'an, and the transactions and the businesses which are prohibited from them. The person has to know it. Another, if a person wants to go and do hajj, then wajab alayhi, it becomes obligatory on that individual, male or female, for them to know the ahkam of hajj. It becomes obligatory on them. So this dabit that al-Imam al-Ajurri rahimahullah mentions, Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah mentions, al-Imam al-Qarafi al-Maliki mentions, is really a good dabit, which is following the qa'ida, ما لا يتم الواجب إلا به فهو واجب. ما لا يتم الواجب إلا به فهو واجب. Anything which an obligatory act cannot be fulfilled without it, then it becomes obligatory as well. So Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, they learn it. And the beneficial knowledge, as we said, where do you get those ahkam from? And where do you take those rulings from? You don't take it from your ahwa, your own whims and desires. The Shaykh mentions here, he says, فَالْعِلْمُ النَّافِعُ, the beneficial knowledge is, هُوَ مَا جَاءَ بِهِ الرَّسُولُ, it is that which the Prophet came with. مِنْ كِتَابِ اللَّهِ, from the Kitab of Allah. وَسُنَّةِ رَسُولِهِ, and the Sunnah of the Prophet. So if somebody asks you, what's the definition of عِلْمُ النَّافِعُ, you will say, هُوَ مَا جَاءَ بِهِ الرَّسُولُ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ, it is that which the Prophet has come with. مِنْ كِتَابِ اللَّهِ وَسُنَّةِ رَسُولِهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. ولذلك ابن القيم says, العلم قال الله قال الرسول قال الصحابة هم ذوي العرفان, ما العلم نسبك للخلاف سفاة بين الرسول وبين رأي فقيه. So العلم قال الله, knowledge is Allah said, and العلم قال الله, قال الرسول, and the messenger said. That is what beneficial knowledge is. ولذلك the poet also says, دين النبي محمد أخبار, نعم المطية للفتى الآثار لا تعدلن عن الحديث وأهله فالرأي ليل والحديث نهار ولربما غلظ الفتى أثر الهدى والشمس بازغة لها أنوار. And the religion of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is what? Al-Athar, textual evidences. So it's an honor when a person takes their rulings from Al-Kitab wa Sunnah. لذلك that's what Allah says to us, وَاتَّبِعُوا مَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكُم مِّن رَبِّكُمْ وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا مِن دُونِهِ أَوْلِيَاءَ. Allah commands us to take back our rulings from what? Follow the Kitab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, عَلَيْكُمْ بِسُنَّتِي وَسُنَّةِ الْخُلَفَاءِ الرَّاشِدِينَ الْمَهْدِيِّينَ عَضُّوا عَلَيْهَا بِالنَّوَاجِدِ وَإِيَّاكُمْ وَمُحْدَثَاتِ الْأُمُورِ فَإِنَّ كُلَّ مُحْدَثَةٍ بِدْعَةٍ وَكُلَّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالَةٍ وَكُلَّ ضَلَالَةٍ فِي النَّارِ, which is the riwayah of Nasa'iyu. Well, the other parts of Imam Nasa'i did it narrative in Hadith Arbaad ibn Sariyah, which is upon you is the, my sunnah and the sunnah of the rightly guided khulafa. Hadith Abu Huraira in Sahihain Bukhari and Muslim, كل أمتي يدخلون الجنة إلا من أبى. قيل ومن يأبى يا رسول الله؟ قال من أطاعني دخل الجنة ومن عصاني فقد أبى. So if we obey the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, then we will enter Jannah. So the علم النافع, the beneficial knowledge is قال الله, Allah said. قال الرسول, the Messenger said. Anything other than that, Imam Malik رحمه الله, what did he say? كل يؤخذ من قوله ويرد إلا صاحب هذا القبر. Everybody else other than that, his statement is either taken or it's rejected. ولذلك الإمام الشافعي رحمه الله يبوء الإجماع على issue. He says, أجمع المسلمون على أن من استنبانت له سنة عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ليس he said, أجمع المسلمون على أن من استبانت له سنة عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ليس له أن يدعها لقول أحد. It's obligatory. It's consensus of the Muslims. If it becomes clear for a person, sunnah al Rasulillah, a sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, becomes clear to you, and it becomes apparent to you, it is not permissible for you to leave it for a statement of an individual. Once it becomes clear to you that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, His Messenger said something, and Imam Shafi'i said, is it ijma' that you can't leave it for because Fulan said it or Alan said it? You can't. ولذلك حتى even if those issues are مسائل which are فروع, even if they are issues which are sub-branches, as some may call it, صح؟ And the evidence for that is قول ابن عباس, أقول لكم قال الله وقال الرسول. I'm saying to Allah said, I'm saying to the Messenger said, وتقول لي قال أبو بكر وعمر. And you are here saying to me, أبو بكر said and عمر said. So what it meant is, and this is the issue of حج التمتع, which is a مسألة فقهية أصالة. Because some people tell you, oh, issues of عقائد, yes, but issues of fiqh and فروع, there are differences of opinions and whatnot. If a دليل comes, صريح, direct, then it is not permissible for you to what? It is not permissible for you to take it, take a statement of a person over the statement of the Messenger, عليه الصلاة والسلام. And this is very dangerous that a person does that. نعم, the author then says,
ويسلكون جميع طرق الدلالات في دلالات فيها.
The Sheikh here, رحمه الله, mentions a point which is some people will say to you, this is important. أهل السنة والجماعة, the beauty about أهل السنة, أبو مظفر السمعاني in his كتاب انتصار لأهل الحديث, he mentions a قول which is very good, and he says that أهل السنة يذكرون ما لهم وما عليهم. أهل السنة don't only just mention what's for them, they also even point out what is against them. They mention it. They are not deceptive individuals. يذكرون ما لهم وما عليهم. And that's the tariqa known by the people of the sunnah. لأنهم يخشون الله تبارك وتعالى. They fear Allah. And whatever they are doing it, they're doing it for لله. For Allah تبارك وتعالى sake. So look what the Sheikh here mentions. He says, ويسلكون جميع طرق الدلالات. أما الدلالات, you can say both ways, فيها in it. Meaning أهل السنة والجماعة, when they're extracting the rulings out of the kitab and the sunnah, They don't just extract the ruling or derive the ruling from dalalat al-mutabaq only, one form of it. But Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, they take the Qur'an and the Sunnah and they extract the rulings from all the different means that it can be taken out of. لأن أهل الأهواء, the people of desires, if the ayah is not explicit and it is not direct, they don't take it. And that's all they will say to you. Is it clear like that? Hatta even within themselves, they are sick. Some of them don't even take the clear-cut evidences. They won't take it. But Ahl al-Sunnah, not only do they take that which is clear-cut, but they also take that which is from the other forms of dilalat. What does dilalat mean? What does it mean? First of all, the dilalat are of two types. First of all, there are two types. Dilalat lafziyah and dilalat ghayru lafziyah. I mean, dilalat ma'naviyah. Are you there? The dilalat which are lafziyah, the dilalat which are lafziyah are three types. The Sheikh is going to mention them right now. When he says, وَيَسْلُكُونَ جَمِيعَ طُرُقِ الدِّلَالَاتِ فِيهَا, he says, what are the three he says?
دلالة المطابقة ودلالة التضمن ودلالة الالتزام.
نعم. Those three, if somebody asks you, what are they? They are دلالات لفظية. They're referring to the wordings. And I want you to understand something because this is very important. It saves you a lot of headache. And that is, if you ever look at the issues pertaining to the khilafat and the disputes that occur, the khilafat that occur within the ulama themselves in Masail al-Fiqh, if you observe the madhahibs that are present, the madhabs that are out there, are you there? There are two madhabs. There are two madhabs when it comes to issues of how to deal with the textual evidences. Are you there? Al-Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah and Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Pay attention. Imam al-Shafi'i and Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal on one side. Al-Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah and Imam Malik rahimahullah on one side. Imam Abu Hanifa and Imam Malik rahimahullah, they are يتوسعون في المعاني. They go a bit more into the issue of ma'na. يتوسعون في المعاني. Within themselves, they're not the same. They're not the same, without a doubt. Are you there? لأن أبو حنيفة رحمه الله was صاحب الرأي. والإمام Imam Malik رحمه الله was what? صاحب الحديث. But they both have maybe not the same quantity, but they are both what? يتوسعون في المعاني. الإمام الشافعي and Imam Ahmed, they are يتوسعون في الألفاظ. The wordings. And I've given examples of this issue of wordings. Are you there? And the issue of ma'ana. The issue of wording and the issue of ma'ana. Ala sabili tamthil, the people who have actually gone extreme in the issue of wordings, extreme on the wordings, and they have nu'min al-jumud. They're a bit stiff when it comes to wordings. And they don't move forward based on ma'ani. And when we say ma'ani, we mean al-ilal and ahkam in the sharia. Are the likes of the zahiriyah. The zahiriyah, they stick with the alfad, and that's what they give importance to. And they don't really look further more into the ma'ani. For example, we say that the hadith of the bikr, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to sta'dhan, that the bikr is sought permission from her. Yeah? Permission is sought from her. Permission is? Is sought from her. Now, if the bikr, how is her permission sought from her? Her silence. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, her silence is a sign of acceptance. The Zahiriya, they took that as its apparent and they stuck by it. So they said that if a woman speaks and she's a virgin and she speaks and she says to her father, "Dad, I do want that guy. I'm interested as you've brought him to my attention. I'm going to take him. I want him." If she says that, they say that she's not going to be married off to him. Because the hadith clearly instructs us that her silence is acceptance. So she has to be silent. Are you with me? And that's not what the sharia meant by that. Does that make sense? Because the sharia here is talking about ma'ani, meaning. You have to look at the wisdom and the reason why the sharia did that. Does that make sense? So the madahibs that are out there are issues of alfad and ma'ani. Observing those two are very important. Are you with me? Observing those two. لذلك كتب أصول الفقه and قواعد الفقهية are books that deal with these issues, and a person by studying those books will learn the correct method in treading on when it comes to how to deal with the wordings and also how to deal with the meanings. And when we step onto the meaning, even that the wording, what it seems from the apparent, we have to furthermore go into the meaning because there's hikmah and wisdom behind the usage here. And when we just stick to the wording, and the wording itself is a proof. Are you with me? And because of that, we find that there's khilafat. A person wants you to just stick, he gives you a word and he places it in your face. He doesn't realize there are hikam and ilal behind it that has been used from it. Because why are they لأن الجمع النصوص, to bring all the texts together so they can all work together. And we've given examples, there's no need for us to go over it again. But from the دلالات اللفظية that have to be observed, and Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah observe them, is the first one being Dilalatul Mutabaqati. Dilalatul Mutabaqati means, it means Dilalatul Lafzi ala Jami'i Ma'na, the whole meaning that are inside the wording. For instance, with an example, it becomes much more clear. If I said house to you today, if I said a house, when the minute I use the word house, what would come to your mind is doors, windows, huh? All of the things that a house consists of, rooms. No, I didn't say all of that. I just said a house. But all of that is what? So this, the doors, are you with me, brothers? Doors and rooms and staircases, مثلا. Back garden, for instance, for some houses, and etc. All of that is referred to with one word. What is it? A house. That's called dalalatul mutabaqa. If I then take part of the house and break it down, this becomes dalalatul tadammuni, which means here dalalatul lafzi ala juz'i ma'na. It just shows part of the meaning. It's like, for example, if I say window, or if I say lock, or if I say, this is now part of the house. The third one, which is called dilalatul iltizam, ama dilalatul iltizam, is dilalatul iltizam is ala amrin kharijin anhu lazimun lahu. It's something that's outside what I have actually mentioned. It's nothing to do with my wordings. It's actually an external point outside my wording. And that is basically, this house must have been made by somebody. If it's got locks and it's this sophisticated and it has all of this together, there has to have been what? Are you there? ولذلك أهل السنة والجماعة, they, when they use the textual evidences, they apply all of these three. They use it in these three. ولذلك Al-Akhdari, Abd al-Rahman Al-Akhdari, Al-Akhdari, in his book Sulam al-Munawraq fi ilm al-Mantiq, he mentions, he says, دَلَالَةُ اللَّفْظِ عَلَى مَا وَافَقَ يَدْعُونَهَا دَلَالَةَ الْمُطَابَقَ وَجُزْئِهِ تَضَمُّنًا وَمَا لَزِمْ فَهُوَ الْتِزَامٌ إِنْ بِعَقْلٍ إِلْتُزِمْ. That, the three lines that we mentioned, so that طالب العلم can just quickly memorize it from there. دَلَالَةُ الْمُطَابَقَةِ دَلَالَةُ التَضَمُّنِ دَلَالَةُ الْإِلْتِزَامِ. With that, الْسُنَّةُ وَالْجَمَاعَةُ, just by these three, they can refute atheists. And if a person has understanding of the Sharia, and he has the Quran, and he knows how to extract the rulings from it, with these three dalala, dalalatul mutabaqa, dalalatul tadammun, dalalatul iltizam, and if we gave time to the Sharia and the Kitab and the Sunnah, wallahi, we wouldn't need external forces to help us to respond to these modern, contemporary problems that we have. But where we have qusur, we're short in how to extract the ruling. We only know dalalatul mutabaqa, even if we do know it. Sahih? Let alone dalalatul tadammuni and dalalatul al-iltizam from the Sharia. So what the Sheikh means by this is that أن فهم النصوص, understanding the nusus, it requires the usage of these three dalala. فَيَسْتَنْبَطُونَ مِنَ الْكِتَابِ وَالسُّنَّةِ أَهْلِ السُّنَّةِ وَالْجَمَاعَةِ extract from the Kitab and the Sunnah, and their sciences بِرِعَايَةِ هَذِي الْأَنْوَاعِ مِنَ الدِّلَالَةِ فِيهَا. They observe these three different types of dilala. They do. ولذلك الشيخ ابن عثيمين رحمه الله, الشيخ ابن عثيمين, الشيخ محمد صالح العثيمين, in his قواعد المثلى, he speaks about it here. He has explanation on his قواعد المثلى, الشيخ ابن عثيمين, and he talks about it. Are you there, brothers? ولذلك he talks about ابن عثيمين, the issue of تكفير المسلمين. When you're making تكفير of a Muslim, right? Can you make a person, can you do تكفير of a person? دلالة المطابقة, a statement that he said, a clear cut statement, yes he did. What about part of his statement? Can you make takfir on him based on it? Dilalatul mutabaqa tadammuni? Na'am. It's juz' min kalamihi, na'am. He said it. Amma dilalatul iltizam? Necessitating from his statement? La. That's why then Sheikh ibn Uthaymeen talks about the issue of lazimul madhab, laysa bilazimin hatta yaltazima bihi sahibu. Are you there? Sheikh Abdul Rahman Nasir Sa'di, you know what he has? He has a ta'liq on the kitab al-kafiyatu al-shafiyah fi al-intisar al-firqati al-najiyah. He speaks about it there as well. The issue of لازم المذهب ليس بلازم حتى يلتزم به صاحبه. Because Ibn al-Qayyim brings it in his Nuniyah. يعني كافية الشافية في الانتصار للفرقة الناجية. عبد الرحمن بن ناصر السعدي deals with it there and he talks about it. So أهل السنة والجماعة, that's how they are with their textual evidences, with the Kitab and the Sunnah. Their understanding is profound. And that's how we are in our, that's where ilmun nafi' is. Beneficial knowledge is the Kitab and the Sunnah. You can extract from it دلالة المطابق, دلالة التضمن, دلالة الالتزام. Strongly. Are you there? And this is exactly where the issue of the قضية الحمل, a woman who gave birth the time of the Sahabas, Uthman رضي الله عنه, that عبد الرزاق بن حمام الصنعاني narrated in his مصنف, or is it أبو بكر بن أبي شيبة, one of the two, either this مصنف or this مصنف, that Uthman رضي الله عنه at his time a woman gave birth in how much? 6 months. And Ali ibn Abi Talib took from the ayat when he brought it together a powerful meaning, dalalatul ishara, which was what? That when the woman gave birth, what?
It'll be 6 months,
24 months. Naam, he says, وحمله 30 شهرا. وحمله وفصاله 30 شهرا. The haml and the breastfeeding is how many?
3 months.
30 months. 30 شهرا. 30 months. Breastfeeding and
the?
And we know from the ayah, والوالدات يرضعن أولادهن حولين كاملين لمن أراد أن يتم الرضاعة. How long is the breastfeeding for?
24 months.
So it's 24 months.
Yeah, 2 whole years.
It's 2 whole years. So if you subtract 24 from 30, how much are you left with?
6.
You're left with 6 months. So the woman can be pregnant in 6 months. Where did he get that Ali ibn Abi Talib from? This is the dalalat that he used. Are you with me? So the Sharia, the Quran and the Sunnah, the usage and the way to extract rulings from it is not amrun hayyin. To say this is a hukum of a mas'ala is not very easy. It's not very easy. It requires nadar, amiq. Are you there? It requires a very powerful observation. It requires a powerful observation. So Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, they observe those three. Dalalatul Mutabaqah, Dalalatul Tadammuni, and Dalalatul Al-Iltizami. Observing those three. And that's what saves the Ahkam from Tahrif and Tabdeel. No distortion, no playing with evidences, and not bringing funny fatawa, shadh, ghariba. When you haven't even understood and comprehended the different types of dilalat there are in the wordings of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Allah tabarak wa ta'ala's book. Naam.
وَيَبْثُلُونَ كُوَاهُمْ فِي إِدْرَاكِ ذَلِكَ بِحَسَبِ مَا أَعْطَاهُمُ اللَّهِ.
The Sheikh says, وَيَبْذُلُونَ, they put so much effort in قُوَاهُمْ, their strength. قُوَاهُمْ here is three types of قُوَى. قُوَى بَدَنِيَة, their physical strength. They physically put effort in. والعقلية and textual, rational strength. And last but not least, مالية, wealth. They do all three types of strength they have in making sure, in what? في إدراكي, to perceive the perception of the Kitab and the Sunnah to be correct. بحسب ما أعطاهم الله, based on that which Allah has given them, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what do? They fully go in the Kitab and the Sunnah, and they use their physical ability. They use their rational, intellectual. They also use their wealth in buying the books they need, and you know, traveling to lands from lands. They do that. They'll put their money in there. So they won't shorten in making sure when they come to the conclusion of this issue, that they come with it with what? They come with it after, بعد بدل الجهد, after they've put in effort and hard work in. And it is not مجرد, it's not just a mere, huh? It's not just a mere fatwa or an answer they just gave. Na'am, like that. Na'am.
ويعتقدون أن هذه هي العلوم النافعة, هي وما تفرع عليها من أقصية صحيحة ومناسبات حكمية. وكل علم أعان على ذلك أو وازره أو
الشيخ رحمه الله says ويعتقدون أهل السنة والجماعة believe they believe what أن هذه العلوم نافع أن they believe what أن هذه هي العلوم النافعة that this is the beneficial knowledge what extracting the rule from the كتابنا سنة based on how many the دلالات which are what دلالة المطابقة دلالة التضمن and دلالة الالتزام and إن شاء الله تعالى try to memorize the line بإذن الله دلالة اللفظ على ما وافق يدعونه دلالة المطابقة وجزئه تضمنا وما لزم فهو التزام إن بعقل التزم so they observe those three and they believe that this is the beneficial knowledge وكذلك and what they also believe is beneficial knowledge is ما تفرع عنها anything that comes out from that such as من أقيسة صحيحة قياس and knowledge which are correct أقياس which is صحيح is what? It's what whatever observes the pillars of قياس what are the pillars of قياس? The أصل the فرع the حكم and the علة جامعة بينهما you have, you have an أصل here the original thing which you're trying to do the analogy from are you there? And what do you have here? You have the فرع the sub-branch so for example you want to now say that drugs is haram You want to say drugs is haram. Now the question is that drugs at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, these powders that are being used and whatnot may not have existed at the time of the Prophet ﷺ. So one person may ask you, where's your evidence for this? So what you now want to do is you want to bring it to something that was at the time of the Prophet that it has something in common with. Are you there? So what you say is that the asr here is what? The asr is the khamar that you have right now that intoxicates. Then you say that the drug is the fara' that I'm trying to use as a the fara' that I'm trying to compare to the alcohol. Okay? The question is that what is it that they have in common? They both what? The illah, which is what they both have in common. What is it? Iskar. They both intoxicate the mind, right? The third thing is now so you've got the asal and the fara', here it is. Then you have the illatun jami'atun baynama, which is the third thing. Now the fourth, which is the final one point you have to bring, which is the hukum. What's the ruling for drugs now? That it's haram. So if you observe the thing like that, the qiyas, you take its points correctly. You do the hukum, the fara', the illah. Are you there? And also the illah, you have to, we'll look into the illah with you. Is it illah mansusa? Did the sharia actually state the illah for this particular thing? Because remember, we know why alcohol is haram. The sharia, what did it tell us? Kullu muskirin haram. Kullu khamrin muskir wa kullu muskirin haram. Didn't the Prophet say that? Alayhi salam, he did. Is it every alcohol intoxicates and every intoxicant is haram? So we have now the Prophet clearly stating the reasoning for why alcohol is haram. But you may come to something you don't have an illah for it. You don't know the reason for why the Sharia prohibited it. Are you there? For example, we have the pork. We know the Sharia prohibited it. What's the reason why the Sharia prohibited it? We don't have a reasoning for it. So some of the scholars, they say that the nahi of it is ta'abudi. Do you see my point? That we worship Allah based on it. This is just ibadah. Are you there? Some scholars will say, no, the point I'm saying to you is that on any particular issue, there's always going to be what's the illah for it. So if you really don't bring the illah out properly, then of course, then what you're trying to compare the two with may be incorrect. And sometimes it happens that a fiqh issue is differed upon by some scholars saying that the illah here that you're using is actually not correct. So of course, if the illah is incorrect, then the hukum that comes out of it is also going to be incorrect. So the point is, Dakin, the point is that the aqisa is sahiha, that the person at least takes those steps. Whether it is differed on or not, that's another issue. But did you take those practical steps? Then na'am, then they consider it to be aqisatun sahiha. Wa munasabat hukmiya, and here I have it, and hakimiya. Which is that it's based on hikmah. وَكُلُّ عِلْمٍ عَالَ عَلَى ذَلِكَ And they also study any knowledge that aids them on that. But it aids them on what? The kitab and the sunnah. Any knowledge that helps you, what helps you? Grammar, usul al-fiqh, are you there? Balagha, and all the uloom that if you study will help you to understand the kitab and the sunnah, they like it. And the Ahlul Sunnah al-Jama'ah, they call this a beneficial knowledge. Sahih, it's the knowledge that we refer to as ilmu ala. The ilm which is instrumental knowledge. It's an instrumental knowledge. And the maqsad, the ultimate goal is the what? is the Kitab and the Sunnah. The Kitab and the Sunnah. ولذلك, some people whose hearts are sick try to put into those sciences which are beneficial, which Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah don't like. And they've taken it out. And they said this is from the harmful knowledges, is what's known as Ilmul Kalam. Ilmul Kalam is not a min al ulum al nafi'ah. It's not from the knowledges that are beneficial. Are you with me? It is not. ولذلك ابن رجب الحنبلي رحمه الله. Are you there? Are you there, brothers? Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali, what did he do? He wrote a book called Fadl Ilm al-Salafi ala Ilm al-Khalafi. And as you know that this book, Fadl Ilm al-Salafi ala Ilm al-Khalafi, is actually taken from what book? This book, Fadl Ilm al-Salafi ala Ilm al-Khalafi, written by Ibn Rajab, what is it that the purpose in why he authored this book, or what was the ultimate reason for it? It was the explanation of the hadith of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, which the Prophet said, Allahumma nas'aluka ilman nafi'a. Oh Allah, I'm asking you about beneficial knowledge. But what Ibn Rajab mentions in this book is very powerful. He mentions something very powerful, something that we mentioned when we were going through the surah, the tafsir of what? Suratul Fatiha. Which is that, first of all, pay attention here. The knowledge that you're learning, pay attention, this is a very important point. First of all, the science that you're saying that is beneficial, it has to be something Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah said is beneficial. So the jins of this ilm, the essence of this, has to be beneficial. Such as, for example, Nahru, Sarf, Balagha, you know, the three types of balagha, ilm al-bayan, ilm al-badi', ilm al-ma'ani, and whatnot. The scholars, they said it's beneficial, it's beneficial. People of the sunnah said it's beneficial, they know it, and they've observed it. Or the ujma' of the ummah is mun'aqid, is connected to this. So that's it. But even then that it's beneficial, it can become a knowledge that's not beneficial if it's taken out of its quantity. So just because its essence is good, if you take it beyond its quantity, it doesn't become beneficial knowledge. Like, as Ibn Rajab mentions, Nahu, for instance, grammar. It's a beneficial knowledge and it's a beneficial science. But taking it above its need, and above in the sense where the person, he preoccupies his time. He's 24/7 studying grammar. Are you there? And he doesn't know Masailul, he doesn't know Tahara, he doesn't know Wudu, he doesn't know Salah, he doesn't know anything from the religion. What does that destroy? It destroys that it's a means. It's a means to what? Fahmul al-kitabi wa sunnah. Understanding the what? Understanding what? Understanding the kitab and the sunnah. So that's why he says it's like adding salt to the food. Sahih? It's like adding salt to the food. Adding salt to the food, if you add too much salt to the food, what will happen? The taste won't be nice, right? What about if there's no salt in this food? It also won't taste nice. So there's an amount that has to be added to it. That's what we said when the Prophet ﷺ said to the companion, the hadith Abi Sa'id al-Khudri, which is in As-Sahihain. But the left is, Sadaqallah wa kadaba batnu akhi. Sadaqallah, Allah told the truth, wa kadaba batnu akhi, and your brother's stomach lied. When the Prophet said to the companion who came to him, and he said, my brother's sick, he's got an ill stomach. The Prophet ﷺ said, Isqihi asalan, give him honey. So he went and he gave him honey, came back, he said, Ya Rasulullah, nothing has changed. The Prophet said, Isqihi asalan. On the second attempt, the man went, he had honey, came back, he gave his son honey, and his son was still ill. The third attempt, the Prophet ﷺ said to him, Isqihi asalan, go and give him honey. So he went and he gave him honey on the third attempt, and now he got better. So what did the Prophet say? He said, Sadaq Allah, Allah told the truth. Because Allah says, وَأَوْحَى رَبِّكَ وَأَوْحَى رَبُّكَ إِلَى النَّحْلِ أَنِ اتَّخِذِي مِنَ الْجِبَالِ بُيُوتًا وَمِنَ الشَّجَرِ وَمَا يَعْرِشُونَ. Allah tells us the honey, the virtues, so surah Allah tabarak wa ta'ala named it after the bee. And also the Prophet told us alayhi salatu wasalam that the asal, the honey, is a shifa for this ummah, right? So Allah told the truth. And your brother's stomach lied. But what is it that the Prophet observed? The honey itself, is it a cure? With the permission of who? Allah? Na'am it is. The second thing is that the amount that's taken is also needed, right? As for knowledge, it's like that as well. If you take ilm al-kalam for so long and you say now it became beneficial knowledge, then asluhu, its essence is what? ولذلك Imam Shafi'i, what did he say? حُكْمِ عَلَىٰ أَهْلِ الْكَلَامِ أَنْ يُطَافَ بِالْعَشَائِرِ وَيُضْرَبُ بِالْجَرِيدِ وَالنِّعَالِ. Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah, what did he say? My ruling on the people of ilmul kalam is what? that they are paraded in the market, and they are whipped with branches, and they are whipped with what? Shoes. And then it said, he said, and then it said, فَهَذَا جَزَاءُ مَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنِ الْكِتَابِ وَالسُّنَّةِ وَأَقْبَلَ الْكَلَامِ. This is the ruling of the one who turns away from the kitab and the sunnah, and he turns towards what? He turns towards ilm al-kalam. وَلِذَلِكَ you find today, وَلِلْأَسَفِ الشَّدِيدِ, people who want to defend the kitab and the sunnah. And they are defending, how are they defending the kitab and the sunnah? They are defending it just by studying philosophy. Ilm al-kalam, and not learning the kitab and the sunnah itself. How are you going to defend the religion without knowing the source of the religion? You don't even speak Arabic. You don't even know the kitab of Allah. You don't even know the sunnah of the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So it's important for a person to study the sciences which are permissible, and not to busy yourself with that which is not permissible. Naam.
أو وازره أو ترتب عليه فإنه علم شرعي كما أن ما ضاده وناقضه فهو علم باطل فهذا طريقهم في العلم.
So here again what he says is they learn the beneficial knowledge and the knowledge that aids the kitab and the sunnah and the understanding of the kitab and the sunnah, and they also stay away from that which opposes the kitab and the sunnah, the sciences, the knowledge that if you do learn, it will cause, or it's opposing, either directly or indirectly, it's opposing the kitab and the sunnah. They are what? They consider this to be ilmun batilun, a knowledge and a science which is false, and they don't take that as a knowledge. And they, so now we've learned something. The first point, which was what? Tariquhum fil ilmi. How is their way in knowledge? Are you there? And it's sad, wallahi, it's very sad, that a people who are calling themselves du'at, they're calling themselves du'at, who call to Allah's path, who when you say to him, Allah said, the messenger said, they'll say to you, akhi, be a bit intellectual. Have a bit of rationale, be a bit rational. Or even mock a person who says, qala Allah, qala Rasul. What else is that you can bring him? Now, if you feel like the way he has extracted the ruling from the kitab and the sunnah is wrong, rebuke him or correct him in the way he's extracted the ruling from the kitab and the sunnah, not his usage of the kitab and the sunnah. What else is it that you wanted him to use? And how is it you can oppose him on the kitab and the sunnah with that which is rational? He's right in the sense of saying Allah and his messenger said, he's right for that, but he might be wrong in how he has extracted the ruling from the kitab and the sunnah. That which is, you praise him for, you say, may Allah bless you for saying, qala Allah, qala Rasul, and knowing that that's your source of evidence. May Allah, but this understanding that you've now come with, this understanding that you've now put forward is incorrect. And then correct him on that. And then teach him what is right. And also teach him how to extract rulings from the kitab and the sunnah. But to take him away from what he's right on, which is the kitab and the sunnah he's brought forward to you, and try to take him to that which is intellect or be rational. هذه الضامة والله. This is a ضامة والله. This is a harm. It's corruption. And it is going against the مزدر التلقي عند أهل السنة والجماعة. The source أهل السنة والجماعة take as their evidences. نعم. So now we finished طريقهم في العلم, their path in knowledge. Three sources. الكتاب والسنة وال إجماع. The kitab and the sunnah is their source, صح؟ And the إجماع هذه الأمة, the consensus of this ummah. The kitab, we understand. What about the sunnah? Whether it is mutawatir or whether it is ahad, and the sunnah don't break it down like that. من حيث العمل. In terms of implementation, for them it's both the same. Whether it is in masail which are furu', and whether they are in masail which are usul. Are you there? That's if we do not tasamuh, the usage of the word usul and furu'. Are you there? Because this word, al usul and furu', the person who's using it has to be a person who clarifies what he means by it. Because the first people who brought the issue of usul and furu', the first people, were the Mu'tazila. Like Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah, many places it is, Majmu' al-Fatawa, he fights against this usage of this word, al usul and furu'. And also his student Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah. But Ibn Taymiyyah also uses it. So what he uses it for is what? That the usul are masail which are daqiq. Sorry, furu are masail which are daqiq. They're detailed, narrowed down matters. Usul are matters which are zahir, apparent. So that's how Ibn Taymiyyah is the khulasa, summary of it. ولذلك there's a risala jami'iyya, dissertation in university of fiqh is Medina or maybe one of the jami'at. A risala jami'iyya was written on it, the issue of al-usul wal-furu' in the Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah. Al-usul wal-furu' in the Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah. This issue of usul and furu' according to Ibn Taymiyyah. Naam. So we've now understood what Ahli Sunnah wal Jama'ah, their knowledge is based upon. Now we're going to take the next point, which is wal amal, implementation. Naam.
وأما طريقهم في العمل فإنهم يتقربون إلى الله تعالى بالتصديق والاعتراف التام بعقائد الإيمان التي هي أصل العبادات وأساسها.
Here he says, وأما طريقهم, their path, أهل السنة والجماعة, في العمل, in terms of implementation, فهم يتقربون إلى الله, they get closer to Allah بالتصديق, in believing, والاعتراف, and acknowledging, التام, complete acknowledgement, بعقائد الإيمان, the issues of إيمان, الإيمان بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسوله واليوم الآخر وتؤمن بالقدر خير وشر, and also مسائل الصحابة, مسائل الصحابة, مسائل الإمامة, all of those. Are you with me? The issue of إمامة, the issue of الصحابة, مسائل مسمى الإيمان that we took, all of those issues which are أصول مسائل هذه السنة والجماعة, قضاء والقدر, all of that which are, they fall under, they believe in those things, what? They believe with in all of that, and they acknowledge all of that with a complete acknowledgement. التي هي أصل العبادات وأساسها. Those which are the أصل of the عبادات, and they are also the أساس of it, its foundation. Meaning, for عبادة, pay attention, this is very powerful. Pray in ظهر, عصر, مغرب, عشاء, فجر. It's not عبادة. It's an عبادة. Fasting in the month of Ramadan. Praying قيام الليل. All of that, what surpasses it is the aqidah issue. The Shaykh is saying the foundation of all of that stands on is your articles of faith. So going and praying Salat al-Dhuhr, or praying Asr, or having good manners and etiquette, are you there? It all goes back to the issue of aqidah. ولذلك, that's why it takes precedence over every other factor of ibadat. ولذلك, we always say, وَبَعْدُ فَالتَّوْحِيدُ علم ينبل على العلوم كلها ويفضل قد أوجب الرحمن منه قدرا ليس يصح الدين حتى يدرى. توحيد takes precedence, greater, and it takes high standard over all the other signs. وبعد فالتوحيد علم ينبل. ما معنى ينبل؟ A نبيل, virtuous, greater than what? على العلوم كلها, all of the sciences that are out there that you can study, there's nothing greater than توحيد. على العلوم كلها ويفضل قد أوجب الرحمن منه قدرا. Allah has made a portion of it obligatory. ليس يصح الدين حتى يدرى. Your religion will not be correct unless you know it. صح. ولذلك, you have to know it. How can you acknowledge something you don't know? So the asas of your salah and those matters are, they sit and they stand on the issue of your aqidah. If a kafir comes to the masjid right now and he does ruku' and sujood and he prays, will he be accepted from him? لماذا? The matter of aqidah is what's been observed here. What about if he has the best etiquette, this kafir? Does that give him virtue over the believer who has bad etiquette? Huh? The thing that's most important in the Sharia, number one, is what? Aqidah. It is the aqidah of an individual. That's what needs to be observed. Now that I've learned the aqidah of Ahli Sunnati wal Jama'ah, we also need to know it's not mujarrad masail al-qalbiyah. It's not just matters of the heart. You learning these matters, it has to resonate, it has to show on you as an individual. And you have to have that aspiration of, if you said, I learned Allah, I know His characteristics, I know His attributes, I know who He is, your fear, your hope, your life, everything about it should be greater. Now.
ثم يتقربون له بأداء فرائض الله المتعلقة بحقه وحقوق عباده مع الإكثار من النوافل وبترك المحرمات ومنهيات تعبدا لله تعالى ويعلمون أن الله تعالى لا يقبل إلا كل عمل خالص لوجهه الكريم مسلوكا فيه طريق النبي الكريم.
Look what they are. يتقربون إلى الله. They learned the aqidah, they studied it, then they get closer to Allah now. بأداء الفرائض, by doing the obligatory acts that are upon them. They come with it. المتعلقة بحقه, that which is connected to Allah's rights. وحقوق عباده, and the rights of his ibadah. مع الاكثار من النوافل. Are you there? By studying what? The نافلة. By increasing in the nawafil, the voluntary acts. وَبِتَرْكِ الْمُحَرَّمَاتِ وَالْمَنْهِيَاتِ And they stay away from that which is haram and that which is prohibited. تَعَبُّدًا لِلَّهِ They do all of that in worship of Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَيَعْلَمُونَ And they also know أَنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى لَا يَقْبَلُ إِلَّا كُلَّ عَمَلٍ خَالِصٍ لِوَجْهِهِ الْكَرِيمِ And they also know that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He doesn't accept any action, whatever it may be, unless it's sincerely done for Him alone. Yeah? And إخلاص, we said, إخلاصنا لله صف القلب من إرادة سواه فحذر يا فطن. إخلاص means that your إرادة, two things you have to observe when you come with sincerity. Your intention, your internally, you're insincere. And also, your action that you're doing, you're only doing it for Him. Both of those, when you observe it, you've come with sincerity. So you do that for Allah تبارك وتعالى. And also, Al-Hafidh Al-Hakim, he says in his Sulam Al-Usul, شرط قبول السعي أن يجتمع فيه إصابة وإخلاص المعا. Two things have to be looked at in order for an action to be accepted. One of the pillars for it is what? It is that it is sincerely done for Allah تبارك وتعالى's sake. You don't do it for anybody else. And we spoke about what إخلاص means. The second one is فيه إصابة. You have to do it in accordance to the Sunnah. شرط قبول السعي أن يجتمع فيه إصابة وإخلاص مع and sincerity. So there has to be إصابة, which is اتباع السنة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. So it doesn't matter how much sincere you are and how much you cry and whether your tears turn into blood or what not. It doesn't matter if it is not in accordance to the Sunnah of the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام. لأن how do you know this is pleasing to Allah? How do you know Allah سبحانه وتعالى loves it? You don't know. Revelation doesn't come to you. The fact that the Prophet didn't mention it, we already know that Allah doesn't. He doesn't love it because there is not a path which Allah, we can get to Him and get Him to be pleased with us. And except He has what? He has set it with it for us. On the tongue of the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, once they have their aqeedah and they believe, they move forward. To what? Bi ada'i al-fara'idhi. Doing that which is obligatory. And then we said, the Iman is what? Aslul. And then fara. The fara is two types, right? Kamaluhu al-wajib and kamaluhu al-mustahab. Ahlul Sunnah wal-jama'ah are not those who stick to the asal of the iman. They are people who go further into the issue. What do? They come with not only fara, kamaluhu al-wajib, they come with what? Kamaluhu al-mustahab. They come with the mustahabbat, the voluntary things. Ja'alani Allah wa iyaakum minha. Ama minhum. May Allah make us from them. Now.
ويستعينون بالله تعالى في سلوك هذه الطرق النافعة التي هي العلم النافع والعمل الصالح الموصل إلى كل خير وفلاح وسعادة عاجلة وآجلة.
The Sheikh says, ويستعينون بالله. They seek help from Allah. أهل السنة والجماعة know. لا حول لهم ولا قوة. They have no strength. They know they have no power. So they seek from Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in taking this path. في سلوك هذه الطرق النافعة. This beneficial path. What was the beneficial path? He clicks on التي هي, that path which is العلم النافع والعمل الصالح. They know that they have no power, they have no strength, they have none of that. Except through who? Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. الموصل إلى كل خير وفلاح. Are you there? and they know the first enemy that can get in their way in gaining beneficial knowledge and righteous action, the first enemy is who? Themselves. They know that. Ahlul Sunnah will know that. ولذلك what did the poet said? Say, he said, إِذَا لَمْ يَكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ عَوْنٌ لِلْفَتَى فَأَوَّلُ مَا يَجْنِي عَلَيْهِ اجْتِهَادُهُ. If the slave does not get aid and support from Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, then the first thing that's going to deviate him and destroy him is his own self. Are you there? So they know that. وَمَا أُبَرِّئُ نَفْسِي إِنَّ النَّفْسَ لَأَمَّارَةٌ بِالسُّوءِ. They know that the nafs, their nafs calls them to evil. Are you there? Then that's what? Calls them to evil. So the first thing when they're asking for help, they are asking from help from their own nafs. Are you there? And they don't want to become slaves for their own nafs. They want to be slaves for Allah. They want Him to be the one that's in control of their affairs. That's why the Prophet's dua was what? Nasiyati biyadik. My affairs is in your hands. Ya Allah, you're the one who controls my affairs. He doesn't want anyone else to control his affairs. Salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. And he doesn't want anyone else to be in he doesn't want his nafs to tell him. Sah? Alayhi salatu wa salam. So what do we know? If a person doesn't follow the kitab and the sunnah, and that's not the path which they take, they are following their own nafs. That's why Allah says, فَإِنْ لَمْ يَسْتَجِيبُوا لَكَ فَعْلَمْ أَنَّمَا يَتَّبِعُونَ أَهْوَاءَهُمْ. If they don't obey you, O Muhammad, and they don't take your path, then know that they are following their what? Their own whims and desires. They can call it, if they want academic knowledge, or they can call it rationality, or they can call it intellectual observation, or whatever the nice technical terms they want to use for it. But the reality is, يَتَّبِعُونَ إِلَّا الظَّنَّ وَمَا تَهْوَى الْأَنفُسُ. What they're truly following is speculation, and they are following what their nafs has beautified for them. They can give it any nice title that they want. Al-ibratu bil-ma'ani. The reality is the meanings, and the reality is what's taking place, not al-mabani wal-alfad, the structure and the wordings that you use for us. Okay? So that's what Ahlul Sunnah wal-Jama'ah believe. إذا لم يكن if it is not for من الله عون للفتى, if Allah doesn't give aid and support to that slave, فأول ما يجنيها عليه اجتهاد, your own اجتهاد, your own striving may even harm you and cause you harm. And that's why when in the salah we pray, we say إياك نعبد وإياك. Why do we say إياك نستعين? The reason is because the ibadah itself, we can't come with it unless we Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala aids us with it. Pay attention here. ولذلك the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, what did he say to Mu'ad? يا Mu'ad, إني لأحبك. Mu'ad, I love you. And because he loved him, he guided him to what he thought. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم knew was good. He says, يا Mu'ad, إني لأحبك. فلا تدعنا, do not leave off. And تقول, to say after every prayer, في دبر كل صلاة. The scholars differed what was the word دبر. Does it actually mean in the final tashahud? Or does it mean when the salah actually finishes and it's over? There's a khilaf of the word دبر. To say what? Allahumma inni ala dhikrika wa shukrika wa husn ibadatik. Allahumma a'inni. Aid me and support me and help me, O Allah. So the Prophet is teaching Mu'ad that you don't have power, Mu'ad. You can come and you can fast and you won't be able to do it unless Allah helps you, subhanahu wa ta'ala. ولذلك the word iyaka in the Arabic language, the word iyaka in the Arabic language is what? Is a damir munfasil. It's a detached pronoun, right? It's a dhamir which is munfasil. Are you with me? In the Quran, iyaka, singular like this, because the word iyaka is singular. Are you there? Has not been found except in Surah Al-Fatiha. It's just only this ayah that comes. Iyaka. It has come other than that, but it hasn't come singular. And this is to show you tawheed, oneness. That the person, when he's saying, you alone we were. So there's two things that you have to observe. First of all, the iyaka is the maf'ul. And na'budu, we worship. Are you with me? You we worship, oh Allah. Are you there? And we're the ones who worship him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have the maf'ul becoming before the fi'l and the fa'il. This itself shows what? Hasr. لأن التقديم ما حقه التأخير يفيد الحصر, right? It shows حصر, exclusivity. That's what's taking place here. But then another point that's been mentioned, إياك is being used, which is a singular. And I haven't used it anywhere else in the Quran except here to show you that the maqam is munasab. It's befitting for it to be what? Allah alone subhanahu wa ta'ala, that you that you only worship, and that only He subhanahu wa ta'ala that you ask help from. That you only ask Him help from subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the person has to realize that through Iyaka na'budu, only you, O Allah, we worship, you're getting rid of what? Al-riya, showing off. Wa Iyaka nasta'in, you're getting rid of arrogance. Iyaka na'budu, O you, O Allah, we worship. So you're not showing off. The second part, wa Iyaka nasta'in, is what? You're not arrogant. You're admitting you're weak, you're unable to come with anything except through Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Na'am.
والحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا.
The Sheikh concludes by saying والحمد لله and praises to Allah تبارك وتعالى رب العالمين, the Lord of the heavens and the earth. ولذلك the word الحمد, the word الحمد is praise, right? And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, what did he say? أفضل ما قلت أنا والنبيون, the best thing me and the prophets have said is what? La ilaha illallah. That's the hadith, Yawm Arafah. And in another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, Afdalu du'a'i, la afdalu dhikri, la ilaha illallah. Wa afdalu du'a'i, alhamdulillah. And the scholars, they said, in the day of Arafah, what does the person say? La ilaha illallah, wahdahu la sharika lah, لَهُ الْمُلْكُ وَلَهُ الْحَمْدُ. And that's why in Arafah, the Prophet ﷺ said, أَفْضَلُ مَا قُلْتُ أَنَا وَالنَّبِيُّونَ, the best thing that me and any prophet have ever said, which is what? لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَحَدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ لَهُ الْمُلْكُ وَلَهُ الْحَمْدُ. Why is it that this is the best? It's because, as Ibn Taymiyyah mentions, is that the person has combined between أَفْضَلُ الذِّكْرِ وَأَفْضَلُ الدُّعَاءِ. أفضل الذكر وأفضل الدعاء. The Prophet is saying this. وأفضل الدعاء is what? الحمد لله رب العالمين. الحمد لله رب العالمين. So it is what Allah تبارك وتعالى wants from you. ثناء الله. It is وصف الله. It is to describe Allah بصفات الكمال. That you describe for Allah complete. You describe for Allah تبارك وتعالى what? Complete characteristics. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. And then you say, wa sallallahu, we take the opinion or the qawl that sallallahu is what? Before I go to sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the word alhamdulillah, are you there? Is the word alhamdulillah is one of the names of who? From that word, the Prophet's name is Muhammad and Ahmed. Sah. He's what? His name is Ahmed and Muhammad. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's the one who praises Allah the most. He's the one who remembers Allah the most. He is? Salawatullahi wa sallam alayhi. Wa sallallahu, the word salah, we take the qawl of Abu Aliyah al-Rayahi, which Bukhari brought in his Sahih mu'allaqan bi sighat al-jazmi, right? Which is what? Tala'ullahi fi mala'il a'la. It is Allah praises him in the high above. Na'am. On his Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa ala alihi and his family. Family, we take the call of an Imam al-Shafi'i, which is that it is what? Banu Hashim and Banu Muttalib, right? They're them two. Wa sahbihi and his companions. And the sahabas are who? Man laqiya an-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mu'minan bi wa mata ala al-Islam. It is anyone who met the Prophet and he died upon Islam, even if there was a time when he apostated, but he did come back, is still a companion. وَسَلَّمَ تَسْلِيمًا كَثِيرًا. And we will conclude there, inshallah. Anything which we have said that was wrong, a shortcoming, is from me and Shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. سُبْحَانَكَ اللَّهُمَّ بِحَمْدِكَ أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ أَسْتَغْفِرُكَ وَأَتُوبُ إِلَيْكَ.